11th October 2020, the twins. We may reject God's invitation or ignorant, but both. So, we are the losers in both the cases. Today's first reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter 25, verses from 6 to 10, and the gospel reading from Matthew chapter 22 verses from 1 to 14 speak about a banquet. The first reading is a part of the so-called Apocalypse of Isaiah, spanning chapters 24 to 27. Here, Isaiah offers a benchmark image of the final eschatological banquet, written well after the return of the captives from the Babylonian exile. It imaginatively and picturesquely projects final victory, not only over the enemies of the Israelites, in this case the Moabites, but also over humanity's invincible enemy, that is known as death. 1 Corinthians chapters 54:7. In Jerusalem, that Isaiah points to, God will be the host of a banquet, exotic and extravagant, with rich food and filled with marrow of well-aged wines strained clear, which will be universal since all peoples will be invited. This celebration, therefore, is both a victory feast as well as messianic banquet. God is the host here who will wipe away the tears from all faces and ensure that all those invited, wining and dining, will be glad and rejoice in his salvation. This victory banquet will later be interpreted as the Messiah Christ's victory over death, since by his own death on Mount Calvary, the shroud that is cast over all peoples, and his messianic kingdom will be inaugurated at the Pentecost. The hand of the Lord is the power of God, soon to be manifested in a new Jerusalem, new church and new covenant, no longer exclusive but universal and all-embracing. This prediction will find echo in Matthew's gospel passage with a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son, and that is what we read today. When we closely read the gospel passage today, we find that those who have been invited give just lame excuses, like going to the fields to work or to do some business and so on. Some of the invitees even kill the workers of the king. Enraged by this, the king sends his troops to destroy the invitees' cities. These and destruction details seem to indicate that the text refers to the events from 66 to 70 AD, that is, the Jewish war and destruction of the Temple of Jerusalem in 70 AD, since Matthew's Gospel is written after that for Jews converted. Finally, the specially invited guests continue with their joyless traditional work with the property and money, while the simple and the lowly now enjoy the banquet of the king. Among the guests, one of them is for the wedding and he is punished. This shows that it is not enough to be invited. One must also prepare oneself. It is insufficient to be chosen. One must also celebrate. One must make oneself worthy of God's invitation. Let us reflect upon one particular thought. That is, we may reject God's invitation either out of ignorance or out of arrogance, but we are the losers. But when we analyze God's invitation, God's commandments, God's voice, all these are found deep within ourselves, in our heart. We call it God's voice or conscience. In Jeremiah 31:33, God says, "I have written my commandments on their hearts." So, it is enough just to look deep within ourselves and listen to Him. Further, we have our parents, the church, the society to teach us about God. So there is no excuse to say that I don't know. There is no room to justify our ignorance of God's words or God's commandments or invitation. Similarly, if we deny God's invitation out of arrogance, again, we are the losers. But again, there is no justification whatsoever for our arrogance. In what way can we afford to be arrogant in our lives? In fact, our arrogance is the result of ignorance of truths about life. We can be happy and satisfied with a few achievements that we have made, but being happy about them is one thing and being arrogant about them is another thing. If at all we have achieved something in life, God, others who made it possible for us. If the same opportunities and circumstances have been with others, they would have also achieved the same and perhaps they would have done even much better. Whatever efforts we make, it is God who blesses them to make it fruitful. Farmers would easily realize this fact. They may toil day and night, but it is God who sends rain from above. If the rains don't come on time, if not in enough quantity, all their toil will be in vain. Similarly, if it rains at the wrong time, again, all their hard work will go waste. So it is God who finally blesses their work to be fruitful. As St. Paul says, "What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as though you did not?" 1 Corinthians chapter 4 verse 7. So we can realize that except sin, all that we have is a gift from God. Further, very often we forget that how others make our lives possible and how much they contribute to our life and our growth. For instance, when a child is born, it is so very helpless that it has to be depending on the parents and others for everything. But for the help of the parents and others, the child would not even survive. Among all creatures, the human baby is said to be so helpless that its very survival depends on others. The child is not capable of anything on its own. It cannot even turn and lie down on its stomach for the first 2 or 3 months. It is always lying on its back. Sometimes it catches its own hair and cries due to pain, and the mother has to come to release the hair from its fists. But for the parents, the family and others, the child would even not learn to walk or talk. Sometimes back, a research was done and the research came out as a book, Wolf Child, and a movie also was made on this name, Wolf Child. The researchers took a 3-day-old baby to a forest and let the child grow, live with the wolves there. And the mother wolf there, due to her maternal instinct, protected the child and the child started growing among the wolves. After 13 years, the researchers went there to find out about the girl. Now the girl is grown-up girl, 13 years old. She is afraid to look at the human beings, but she is very much at ease with the wolves around. She is making noise and yelling like wolves. She is not able to utter any word in any language. And above all, she is not able to stand on her 2 legs and walk straight, erect. And she is crawling on all the 4 legs, 2 knees and 2 hands. Now the point is, the child is born as a human child with all the faculties of a human being, with all the chromosomes, genes and so on. But the child is not able to talk or walk now, because when the child was 8 months or 1 year old, no one was there to hold her hands to teach her walking, or the child did not have anyone to teach her how to speak, and the child could not imitate the words or the language or the sound that we make by speaking. Therefore, the child is not able to walk or talk now, even at the age of 13 years. So this shows that We are able to talk and walk, it is because of the others. But for the others, we would not even have realized these faculties of talking and walking. And this shows how much we receive from the others and how much we depend on others. When one realizes all this deeply, then one can easily understand that it is foolishness to be arrogant on our part. And arrogance is the result of ignorance. Therefore, today, let us reflect upon how we accept God's invitation. Sometimes we tend to reject God's invitation either because of arrogance or because of ignorance. But since we cannot justify both, we are the losers. Let us think about it today. Thank you.